Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is January 1st, 2017. This is the first Sunday of the new year. Today we have a guest pastor, Reverend Dr. Jerome Taylor. St. John's Lutheran Church is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. St. John's has a midweek service at 6:30 on Wednesday evenings in the chapel. Communion is celebrated the first and third Sundays of the month and every Wednesday evening. St. John's has a food pantry open every Wednesday from 9 o'clock to 9:45. Outreach store open from 9:30 to 1 o'clock Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Fridays, closed on Thursday. Rainbow table every Friday from noon to 1. Everyone is welcome.
From the beginning, by virtue of our baptism, we are called Christian. We were christened at the font. Bearing his name, we share the same Father and are invited to address him intimately as Abba. Jesus bears our sins in humble obedience to the will of the Father. Today we pray that the mind of Christ, whose name we bear, would be our own. It is a good way to begin again another year. Amen?
Amen.
The confession may be found on page 94. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
God, all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sins and live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may be light in your will, and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
The grace of our Savior Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh, born of Mary, be with you. Okay, some of you are wondering who I am. My name is Jerome Taylor. I'm just a poor, humble parish priest, retired from New York, living in Columbus now. My wife, Bethany, is here with me. And we're so glad that I was asked to come and join you on this first day of the year. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So I'm pretty easygoing. We're going to follow the liturgy the best we can. If I make a mistake, you better not tell your pastor. Amen. That's a deal. We can erase tapes. We can fix that. I can send a whole new tape. So I'm so glad to be here. So let us worship God in this new year. And I don't know if you normally have an announcement. I wasn't sure that would be our main announcement that you need made before we move ahead.
No.
He'll be back Tuesday. Amen. So then we'll continue with the hymn of praise, ELW 294, and the Leap Midwinter. Sing with passion. Amen.
Readings today by Connie Singleton.
The Lord has come, let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare her room, and heaven and nature sing. Let us pray. Bless Connie, O God, as she proclaims to us the scriptures, and open the mangers of our hearts to welcome the King,
morning.
The first reading is from Numbers 6 chapter. The Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Speak to Aaron and his sons, saying, thus you shall bless the Israelites. You shall say to them, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. So they shall put my name on the Israelites, and I will bless them." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. the gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, O Christ.
Incarnating mind of Christ. Incarnating the mind of Christ. Incarnate means to embody in flesh, to give bodily form, to actualize. The embodiment of a quality, idea, principle, etc. So we're going to talk about being Christian in this brand new year. If we're going to talk about being Christ-like, if we're going to talk about being a strong, effective, faithful member in the body of Christ, then we need to talk about incarnating the mind of Christ. Amen? Now, there is no passage of Scripture in the whole of the Bible that unveils the mind of Christ with the crystal clarity as does this passage presently under consideration. If you really want to know how to be Christian, if you really want to know how to commit to a deeper faith, if you really want to know how to be Christ-like, if you really want to know how to be a strong, effective, faithful member in the body of Christ, then you better check out Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11, because it was written to illustrate what ought to be the attitude of the people who profess to know and to follow the person of Christ. And when you profess to know and follow Christ, then the way you relate to people changes. Now let me open up a window for you to look into so you know what I'm talking about, that the way you relate to people changes. There's a story about a pastor's wife, it ain't my wife, so let's get that straight. A pastor's wife telling about her day, and she said, the other day I went to a local religious bookstore where I saw a Hunk If You Love Jesus bumper sticker. I bought it and I put it on the back of the bumper of my car, and I'm really glad I did. What an uplifting experience followed. I was stopped at a light of a busy intersection, just lost in a thought about the Lord, and hadn't noticed that the light had changed. That bumper sticker really worked. I found lots of people who love Jesus. While the guy behind me started humming like crazy, he must have really loved the Lord because pretty soon he leaned out of his window and yelled, Jesus Christ! As loud as he could. It was like, you know, at a football game with him shouting, go Jesus Christ, go! Everyone else started honking too. So I leaned out my window and waved and smiled at all those loving people. There must have been a guy from Florida back there because I could hear him yelling something about a sunny beach, and I saw him waving in a funny way with only his middle finger stuck up in the air. Well, recently I asked my two children just what that meant, and they kind of squirmed and looked at each other and giggled and told me that it was a Hawaiian good luck sign. So I leaned out my window and gave them the good luck sign back. A couple of people were so caught up in the joy of the moment that they got out of their cars and they were walking towards me. I bet they wanted to pray. But just then I finally realized that the light had changed, and so I stepped on the gas. It was a good thing that I did because I was the only car to get across that intersection. I looked back at them standing there, and I leaned out of the window and gave them a big smile, and I held up a Hawaiian good luck sign as I drove away. Praise the Lord for such wonderful folks. So you see, when you profess to know and to follow Christ, the way you relate to people changes. Amen? Now, Paul in this text unveils mysteries about the mind of Jesus Christ, and he said in these verses reasons that we ought to incarnate the mind of Christ. He said, let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. Now, he begins by unveiling, first of all, what the mind of Christ is, an attitude of love, an attitude of love. Look at verse 6. You got the lesson there. Who though he was in the form of God. Now, that word form there literally means an outward expression of a person's inner essence. It means the visible manifestation of inward reality. He's saying that Christ is a visible image of the invisible God who being in the form of God. Let's see if I can give you a window to look into. You know, very often, you know, we hear commentators referring to athletes. We may hear them say, she's coming into her form. And what he's saying is that the athlete is demonstrating outwardly what she is inwardly. Now,
she is what she's always been, but now she's informed because she's outwardly demonstrating what she is inwardly. Therefore, when Paul says, who being in the form of God, what Paul was saying is that God so loved the world that he gave his inner essence as an outward expression of his eternal love. But in that same verse, he moves on, still talking about the love of God. He says, did not count equality with God something to be grasped. In other words, he thought it not robbery. He thought it not necessary to hold on to his equality with God. He thought it not beneath him to divest himself with the trappings of divinity. Christ, who thought it not something to be held tightly to himself. Christ, who thought his equality with God was not something to hold on to himself, but because of the greatness of his love, he was willing to relinquish his heavenly glory and unseat his throne of power and drop his royal robe and step across 42 generations and incarnationally identify with the improperness of people in order to become the savior of the world. He thought it not robbery to give up his equality with God. He is saying that love made him do that. Love made God give his inner essence as an outward expression of his eternal love. Now let me make an application right about here. Christ thought it not robbery to divest himself of the trappings of divinity. But let me ask you, you do want to be recognized as a faithful member in the body of Christ who is committed to a deeper faith. Is it robbery then to ask you to share your talent, to share your time, to share your treasures for the extension of God's kingdom on planet Earth? Is it robbery to ask you on Sunday for an hour or more of sustained listening so that when you leave church, you may be qualified to articulate both the law and the love of God? Is it robbery to ask you through the week to work and witness so that the world might be one with Jesus Christ? Is it robbery to ask you to study God's word so that you might be a true disciple of Christ? Is it robbery to ask you to invest time in young people so that they might cultivate Christian principles and values? Is it robbery what we have experienced with Christ? Is it robbery to ask you to share your story so that somebody else might have an encounter with faith? Is it robbery? The love of God made him give himself. And when it comes to being a member of the body of Christ, there are some four-letter words that we need to revitalize with appropriate action in 2017. Give, live, pray, hope, help, sing, work, lead, grow, walk, dare, join, live, talk, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Now let's look at the second thing. In verse 7, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. A life of love is always followed by activity of lowliness. Now, a life of lowliness begins with a life of poverty. Look at verse 7. But emptied himself. He emptied himself not of divinity, but of the deathlessness of divinity. He emptied himself not of righteousness, but of the rights that accompanies his righteousness. He emptied himself not of majesty, but the manifestation of divine majesty. He emptied himself not of purpose, but of heavenly power. Divinity stepped inside humanity and emptied himself. A life of power. And over there, in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9, it says, for you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, that he through his poverty might be rich. Now, what that verse is talking about is where our Lord was before he came down here. It's talking about our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, high lifted up in the unscaled and unscalable heights of Godhead, somewhere in the triune personality, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, that there is a throne, the throne of the Ancient of Days. And upon that throne, the Lord Jesus Christ sat perpetually praised by the perfect anthems of angelic choirs, while the elders everlastingly, casting down their glittering crowns at his feet, cried in unceasing celestial rhythm, holy, holy, holy. And he gave all of that up, took off his royal robe spangled with the stars of heaven, and stepped across 42 generations to wrap himself up in human flesh in order to taste death so that we might taste eternal life. Should have been an amen riding down through there, amen. Amen. See, one of the great tragedies of modern Christianity is that we're so self-centered. Now, I'm not talking about you, just the one sitting next to you. See, nobody is willing to make a sacrifice. You heard the story about the pig and the chicken? Well, a pig and a chicken were walking past the church one Sunday morning and said the chicken to the pig, you know, those folks over the years at St. John, they've been pretty nice to us. I think we ought to do something nice for them. The pig said, good idea. What do you have in mind? The chicken said, well, I think we ought to have a banquet for them. I'm all for that, said the pig, but what shall we serve them? Bacon and eggs, said the chicken. Oh, no, not in your life, said the pig. For you, that's just a small contribution. You just lay an egg or two, but for me, it's a total commitment. I have to die. You see, nobody's willing to make a sacrifice. Nobody is willing to live a life of poverty. No, they just empty themselves for self. You ever heard of the word unteological egotism? It's a big word that means self curved in on self, self-centeredness. It's like you can't walk past a mirror without kissing yourself, and that's why your lips are so chapped. Self-turned in on self. That's why our lights are now punching holes into the darkness of society, because we're bent in on ourselves, guilty of unteological egotism. But let me tell you something, St. John. There's a story about a mouse who one day looked through a crack in a wall to see the farmer and his wife opening a package. What food it might contain. And he was aghast to discover that it was a mousetrap. So retreating to the farmyard, the mouse proclaimed the warning, there's a mousetrap in the house, a mousetrap in the house. The chicken clucked, and scratched, and raised her head and said, excuse me, Mr. Mouse, I can tell that this is of great concern to you, but it is of no consequence to me. I cannot be bothered. So the mouse turned to the pig and told him, there's a mouse trap in the house, there's a mouse trap in the house. Well, I'm so very sorry, Mr. Mouse, sympathized the pig, but there is nothing that I can do about it but pray. Be assured that you are in my prayer. The mouse turned to the cow. The cow said, like, wow, Mr. Mouse, a mouse trap, like, I'm in grave danger, duh, not. So the mouse returned to the house, head down and dejected, to face the farmer's mouse trap alone. That very night, sound was heard throughout the house, like the sound of a mouse trap catching its prey. The farmer's wife rushed to see what was caught. In the darkness, she did not see that it was a bitter snake whose tail the trap had caught. The snake bit the farmer's wife. The farmer rushed her to the hospital. She returned home with a fever. Now, everyone knows that you treat fever with fresh chicken soup. Y'all do that down there? Fresh chicken soup. So the farmer took his hatchet to the farmyard for the soup's main ingredient. The wife's sickness continued so that friends and neighbors came to sit with her around the clock. To feed them, the farmer butchered the pig. The farmer's wife did not get well, and a few days later, she passed away. So many people came to her funeral that the farmer had the cow slaughtered to provide meat for all of them to eat. So, the next time you hear that someone is facing a problem in the church or in the community and think that it does not concern you, remember that when there's a mouse trap in the house, the whole farmyard is at risk. Amen. See, God needs dependable people who show up to help when somebody has a need. Is anybody here willing to develop a life of poverty so that somebody else might be rich? Is anybody here willing to live a life of sacrifice so that somebody else might become a greater servant? Is anybody here willing to become poor in study so that others might become rich in understanding? Is anybody here willing to become poor in energy so that others might become strong in evangelism? Is anybody here willing to become poor in prayer that others might become rich in practice? Is anybody here willing to become poor in times that others might become rich in theology? Is anybody here at St. John willing to invest in young people so that they might become rich in standards, rich in values, and rich in principles? You want to be a strong, effective, faithful member in the body of Christ in 2017. You must live a life of poverty. Not talking about so much about economics and financial, so relax, but more so. An attitude, a life of poverty, of giving of yourself so that somebody else might be made rich. But not only that, a life of poverty. Paul says in that same verse, taking the form of a slave. I know your translation says servant, but from the original Greek, it's doulos, it's slave. So first of all, it's a life of poverty, but secondly, it's a life of slavery. Now, I know that talking about slavery to some people don't go over too well, it certainly don't go over too well with me, but what he's talking about is being a slave to Christ. And whoever is a slave to Christ is a servant to people. You get that? So you want to be a strong, effective, faithful member of the body of Christ, be a servant. He said, you've got to be prepared to live a life of slavery, which is also a life of service. You remember the perfect example of this principle over there in the 13th chapter of John when they had the Last Supper. You know, I think you might hear this text on Good Friday or Monday, Thursday. And the disciples, you know, when they came inside after walking the dusty roads of Palestine, when you come into your house in a Palestinian house, the first thing that happens is that the servant would meet you at the door and bend down, untie your sandals, and wash the dust off of your dirty, stinking feet. Y'all get the picture? But this was Passover, so everybody was off. So the disciples were all standing around when they came inside, because there was no servant there to do that duty. And it was the custom for the servant to meet you at the door in order to wash the dust off your feet. Well, the servants of the house were gone. It was just Jesus and his disciples. And Jesus, you know, able to read their minds. You don't mind if I use my sanctified imagination, don't you? Come with me and walk with me and make our way into their minds and their heart. Jesus sees them all just standing there, and he looks at Peter, and Peter is thinking in his mind, surely they don't expect me to wash their feet. Jesus just said he's about to leave. Somebody's got to lead the movement. The movement just can't die with Jesus, and it is beneath me to get down and wash their feet. Nobody's going to follow a foot washer, and so I can't subject myself to such a menial task. I'm trying to be the first pope. I can't do that. And Jesus went on down the line, all thinking similar thoughts. And he got on down to Bartholomew. And Bartholomew, because he was the least, he was thinking, now, man, I know they expect me to do it because I'm the least of all. And I always get the dirty duty. I always get the assignment that's menial, that insignificant, trivial, and unessential. And Bartholomew thought in his mind, you know, I'll never go up the corporate ladder if I keep doing those kinds of jobs. One day I'm going to be a part of the big three. And so in order to get there, I got to stop doing these kinds of jobs. Wash somebody's feet. I don't think so. I thought of you don't play that no more. I'm going to fool them tonight. I'm not washing anybody's feet. And while they were all standing around looking at each other, the Bible says that Jesus reached over and got him a towel and girded himself with that towel and got him a basin and a pitcher of water and started washing the disciples' feet. Are y'all walking with me? And it looked like when he got to Peter, Peter said, no, Lord, you're not going to wash my feet. What are people going to say when they hear of our king with a towel You need something more than a towel, Jesus. Maybe you need a sword. But Jesus said, but no. My way is with a towel. Peter, if I can't wash your feet, you have no part in me. It looked like I hear Peter say, well, Lord, not just my feet, but wash me all over. A life of slavery. A life of a servant. It looked like I hear Jesus say, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am meek and lowly. You do know that Christians misunderstand meekness. We believe that meekness is weakness. But I came by to tell you, St. John, that meekness is not weakness. Meekness is strength under control. Meekness is the humility of Christ. But not only that, a life of slavery and a life, but also a life of tragedy. Look at verse 7 and 8. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. That in your text? You see, death is tragic. Now, we know that God has a way of bringing triumph out of tragedy. But he's got to have the tragedy in order to bring the triumph out of it, amen? See, death is still tragic. Are you walking with me? Nobody go to sleep today. See, if you're going to be a strong, effective, faithful member, if you're going to commit to a deeper faith, if you're going to incarnate the mind of Christ, then lead a life of poverty, lead a life of slavery, and lead a life of tragedy. Listen, everybody come a little bit closer. God has never used anyone who has not experienced great tragedy. Did you hear that? God has a way of taking a spade of sorrow to dig the well of joy. You see, if you haven't been hurt, then you don't know what it means to really have joy. You see, you can't drink grapes. You can't drink grapes. Take my word for it. Don't try to get choked. That means that no one can be greatly used of God if he or she rejects God's crushing process. You can't be used of God until God has made you into wine. And the reason is, because you can't drink grapes, you must be made into wine. And in order to be wine, you got to go through God's crushing process. And the crushing process comes through a life of tragedy. If you're going to participate in the redemptive drama and the redemptive movement with God, you have to be willing to go through a life of tragedy. God does not use anybody, not even his son, in the movement of redemption without tragedy. He became obedient unto death, even death on the cross. Now just walk with me to the cross. Now when you're at the foot of the cross, you see a holy God dying for sinful people. And look like on that crucified Friday, God in Jesus Christ was dead all day long. And now let's move on to crucified Friday, from Friday to Silent Saturday, where it looks like I can't get a word through to heaven. Looked like God had just cut me off. Like Job, I went to my left, but I couldn't find him there. And I moved to my right, but I couldn't find him there. And like Job, I had a subpoena from God that I couldn't serve because I couldn't find him. It was Silent Saturday, and a whole lot of folk can't cope with Silent Saturday. A whole lot of folk fall apart on Crucified Friday. But I tell you, St. John, hold on. Don't throw in the towel. God is still with us. We can go on because God is our protector, because Christ is our traveling companion, because the Holy Spirit is our comforter and guide. So don't quit yet. It may be a Friday in your life, but hold on. Resurrection Sunday is still coming. God has a way of resurrecting things. And I count on that. I retired after 31 years of ministry. Lost my hair serving the people of God. But I know when I get to heaven, since God is still in the resurrection business, he's going to resurrect every single wave strand back. So you might be having a crucified Friday, but hang on a while. You belong to God, amen. And then Paul says in verse 9, therefore God highly exalted him. We looked at an attitude of love. We looked at an activity of loneliness. But I want to close this message. Yeah, I'm about to close now. Looking at the ascendancy of life. You know, Jesus Christ, What is a formula for going up? Somebody here wants to get to heaven someday, but you've been practicing the wrong principles. Christ in these verses gives us the formula for going up. He says, God has highly exalted him. Now, it's amazing that we say of Christ that he's the greatest personality that ever lived, but then we turn around and reject the principles that he lived by. You want to go up? Listen, he gives us the formula. You want to be first? Be last. You want to be great? Be a servant. You want to have? Give. You want to live? Die. I tell you, Christ gives us the formula for going up. It's the ascendancy of life. When Jesus caught that cloud and went back to his dad, he rose above everything. He rose above trials, and he rose above tribulations, and he rose above sickness, he rose above suffering, and he rose above dying, and he rose above death. And what that tells me is that as we stay with the Lord, we're rising every day. We still get sick, but we're rising. People still do us wrong, and people talk about us behind our back, but we're still rising. And I know that someday we will all die. Now, you're not going to take my word for it, just in case. Just keep living long enough. But the story is not going to end there. Because he lived, we will live. Because he rose, we will rise. Because he lives in heaven, we will live in heaven. And then it says, God gave him a name, which is above every name. In the Old Testament, the name is I Am. In the New Testament, the name is Kyrios. It means Lord. It means the dignified one. It means the holy one. It means ruler. Jesus Christ is Lord. He said, bow your knee only to me. Pledge your allegiance only to me. Give your loyalty and obedience only to me. I am worthy, I am able to establish in you and in the world peace, love, and joy. So there you have it, Saint John. You want to incarnate the mind of Christ? You want to be a strong, effective, faithful member in 2017? You want to commit to a deeper faith? Then live a life of love. Then live a life of humility. Then live a life of poverty. Then live a life of a servant. Then live a life of service. And then live a life of tragedy. And then live a life of ascendancy. That's incarnating the mind. Amen.
Child is this, January the 1st, 2017, Happy New Year, St. John's Church. Dr. Jerome Taylor is our guest minister today.
Oh, Those who came, please rise. Let us pray as those set free from the law and justified by faith, knowing that the Father delights to hear our prayers for the sake of Christ Jesus to our Lord. Our response today is, hear our prayer. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. The heavens are the work of your fingers, yet you are willing to save us in the most humble and sacrificial ways. On the eighth day after being born of the Virgin Mary, your Son was already at work for our salvation by fulfilling your law and shedding his blood. Receive our thanks for the gifts of righteousness and grace from his life of perfect obedience and death in our place for our sins. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Almighty God, in your good and gracious will, you ordained that infant Jesus might labor for our salvation. Grant that we might always recognize that the smallest and the frailest among us are instruments of your blessing and under your protection, and give us steadfast boldness to defend the lives of the weakest among us. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord God, we were held captive under the law and condemned by our sin until your Son set us free by his life, death, and resurrection. We give you thanks that we are heirs of your kingdom by grace through faith, and we pray that this gift of salvation might kindle us in gratitude and desire to fulfill your law and obey your commandments in service to you and in love for one another. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
O Lord, you declare that Christ Jesus there is another, neither Jew nor Greek, slave or free, male or female, for we also are all in one in him. Preserve us from all ungodly prejudice and all same time. Preserve us in the awareness that you bless servants and masters, males and females, with distinct and specific callings. Give that we might resent you. You are placed us nor what you have created us to be, but give us hearts that rejoice to serve as you have ordained, Lord, in your mercy. O Lord of hosts, you declare that sinners cannot look upon your face and live without their unrighteousness. Yet for the sake of Christ, you now cause your face to shine upon us, and you are gracious to us. Bless and keep your grace, and especially remember those in need who cry out to you for mercy, according to your will and wisdom. Lift up your countenance upon them and give them peace, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, you have clothed us with Christ and his righteousness and holy baptism, and now you give us his body and blood for the forgiveness of our sins. Grant to us who receive your Holy Supper that the day humble our hearts and acknowledge their sins and rejoice in your undeserved grace. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You made your Son a little lower than the heavenly beings for our salvation, and now he sits enthroned in heaven, crowned with glory and honor. Receive our thanks for all of your people who have gone before us and who bore your name in this world and now stand before you in heaven. Bless us all in this new year, that we preserve your name and faith until the day that when we also stand before you in glory, through your Son, Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated. Let us pray. Holy God, gracious and merciful, you bring forth food from the earth and nourish your whole creation. Turn our hearts to those who hunger in any way, that all may know your care, and prepare us now to feast on the bread of life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Hallowed be thy name.
come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Taste and see that the Lord is good.
Thank you.
We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this healing power of this gift of life. In your mercies, strengthen us through this gift in faith, toward you in fervent love, toward one another. For the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
God blesses us and sends us in mission to the world. O God, whose grace and truth are revealed in the Word made flesh, bless those who go forth to share your word and sacrament with our absent brothers and sisters. Nourish and strengthen those who receive this holy communion, that through the body and blood of your Son, all may rejoice at his birth and in his presence among us now and forever. Amen. God's gift is for you. Not in a package, but in a manger. Not under a tree, but nailed to one. Not for a price, but freely given. Not for a season, but for all time. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. Go tell it on the mount.
Our closing hymn today, January the 1st, 2017, Go Tell It on the Mount, Negro Spiritual. It was first sung by the Jubilee Singers, Nashville, Tennessee, but it's been sung many generations before that. Go Tell It on the Mount. Services at 8 o'clock. Sunday school is at 9:15 and the 10:30 service. We also have a midweek service at 6:30 in the chapel where we receive Holy Communion. You can receive Holy Communion. It's celebrated the first and third Sundays of each month, festivals, and every Wednesday evening. So we really believe in the presence of Jesus Christ, how he comes, has come to give us eternal life. We thank you for our guest pastor today, Reverend Jerome Taylor. He preached on incarnating the mind of Christ. In the name of Jesus, January the 1st, 2017. We're happy to have you worship with us anytime. come in person or listen to us on YouTube. We're here to proclaim Jesus' name, his incarnation, the mind of Christ, to do his will, to be a servant, to follow him through everything. We thank you for celebrating January 1st, 2017. Our usual pastor, Pastor Pollock, is out of town. Guest pastor, Dr. Jerome Taylor, Reverend Dr. Jerome Taylor, preached the sermon today. In the name of Jesus, is the day we're celebrating, January 1st, 2017, St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Come join us anytime.